I didn't start life as an artist or someone with that type of aspect of my life. I was a very good high school mathematics student, and I went to MIT to study mathematics. And so there is a mathematical element that has attracted me to the mobiles. There are a few things that were really particularly interesting to me as a college student. I was pretty confused, so I was trying to figure things out and looking for truth. But I was a mathematician, so what do you do with math to find that? And it was philosophy of mathematics, and I got really pretty deep into mathematical logic. I took all the graduate courses I could in foundations of mathematics, none of which has been particularly practical in any other way, but that aspiration for something that seems like truth, whether it's through art or logic, that was being expressed there. Work with art doesn't exist out of the context of the rest of life. It somehow reflects an aspiration. So the aspiration to make sense of life and to be able to live within it gracefully and without being swept up and identified with it, to be free within it. I mean, so that's a core aspiration. So in terms of life, or in terms of the larger world, part of what we do to stay alive, to keep things churning inside, is to push that envelope periodically and do something new, like as a mathematician or a computer programmer, to then work with art is a way of pushing outside of that, and then a new kind of balance develops. As a student, I had the feeling of wanting to be something else. There was something wrong in my mind at that point in terms of being so logical or being a mathematician. And I did try a number of little avenues that never quite panned out. If we want to stay alive inside, we always have to look for those opportunities to do something that's not impossible, but enough outside of our normal envelope that we disrupt the balance that we're getting locked into. Another great class I took was another math course, the only applied math course in galactic dynamics, numerical simulation of colliding galaxies. It's still not known why disk galaxies become spirals. So there's a lot of math in that, very difficult math to try to simulate the behavior of disks. One of the things I really got into doing was going into the MIT library, and they had a full set of Sloan's sky survey. So all these negative plates, white with black galaxies and stars on it, and look at them with a magnifying glass and see all these different shaped galaxies, getting a sense of space and the scope and the awe. I wanted to get a sense of what the space was like, so I built a model of the local group of galaxies. And so maybe the Milky Way was about this big, little disk, and I got the celestial coordinates of these and projected them into galactic coordinate space. So we had the two little the Magellanic clouds, the satellite galaxies, the Milky Way, little blobs of epoxy painted with day glow, Andromeda, and M33, which is a beautiful little spiral, and ended up with a space about this big with these little galaxies in it. Totally useless for the class, but it was really helpful to get a sense of like how open the space is. It really didn't connect with something specific that worked until 20 years ago. And at that point, I was hanging around with a group of local artists here. The painters were studying the masterpieces, making copies of the masterpieces, making apres, which is a traditional way of learning art. You really get to know what that particular artist is if you're copying a Picasso or copying a Cezanne. You're trying to get everything right and you start connecting with it. My friend Claude, kind of like me, more of a technical guy, and he couldn't see himself painting like that. He didn't have those skills, but he was starting to look at Alexander Calder, these mobiles. Calder was the person who took mobiles from a little kitsch thing and actually made it into something recognized as serious art. Well, gee, I can do that because all we need is not brushes, but, oh, a set of shears and cut metal and file it. It's hardware store art. I mean, I've gone beyond what you get from the hardware store, but you can build this all with very simple techniques. So I got a bunch of Calder books and I started working with these things and started by making copies and then learning the forms and, you know, and then making whatever came to mind developed from that. This piece here, in fact, is a quick study I've just done recently. I went back to do this study of Calder piece. It's a very elegant set of shapes. I mean, not all of Calder's work is like this, but that aspect of the of basic elegance, whatever it was something that I was attracted to. And there's a lightness and a joy about mobiles. One of the things Calder said, a mobile is a modest thing. You don't have to go in as an artist and say, I'm making deep art, I'm, you know, dealing with my inner demons. It's actually a different kind of mood that comes from it. And you end up with something that it's just some shapes floating in space. That's it. Calder came from a family of sculptors. His father, his grandfather were both artists, and yet he went to engineering school. After that, he came back and started doing this art. Any art, there's an element of technique, and here it's very simple, and it is more like engineering in that there's a set of basic trade-offs that you make in designing a piece, in the composition of a piece. There's a sense of sweep upward, sense of the composition of how close it is. You can't really see in the book is how it actually floats in space. I've worked with this kind of material enough that I can imagine how it's going to work. You can see right now as it kind of calms down, this is a piece that's designed that it's mainly going in a line, but there's so many joints and it's going to pick up because of these surfaces, will pick up the air so much, here it's winding itself up that way. And eventually it's going to hit the point where it's gone as far as it can and it may start unwinding. It's hard to tell. This can be an energetic process to cut metal, to file metal, and there's some kind of concept of an outcome as well. So I'll sometimes work with that mood by having music on that's, I think, kind of brings me into that place. And it's necessary to step back quite a bit and just look at what it is and kind of reconnect with the sense of space. There's a lot of empirical knowledge that comes from working with the material over time of if I bend these nice arcs into the piece, they give it, a smoother shape than if these were straight, but it will be more stable. It won't bounce up and down so much. You won't have as much of that kind of motion. So what happens when something moves off of balance is part of balance. A piece like this changes shape a lot, from being all the way straight out to being maybe wrapped like this or wrapped the other way or wrapping one direction, and that's changing all the time. It's what a mathematician would call a chaotic system. Back to the point about our place in the universe, a lot of these shapes are inspired by forms in nature. So if I look at this piece, These, maybe they're leaves, maybe they're feathers, but they're types of shapes that you'd see. And this is something I found myself doing a lot, is making pieces that are somehow inspired, sometimes by human things, sometimes by natural things. Like, here's a very simple little shape. I don't know if it's a jet or a rocket, but it also has an organic aspect. I mean, this could be a ray going through the water. It's not necessary to really know what it is exactly, or for people to get the same impression that I have working with it. These natural forms, whether they end up being anything that's at all realistic, that's like something that actually exists on Earth, is something else. Some pieces are more literal. Behind me, there's a couple fish swimming in a circle. It's hard to see them as anything other than fish. Other pieces, like this piece, what is it? Different pieces have different characteristics. Some, they move a lot, but they don't really change their overall shape that much. The silver flouche, it's moving around quite a bit, but it always has that same basic, these four leaves, whatever they are, they're moving in a spiral. So that's its movement, rotation with a little bit of bounce to it. So I work as a software developer. I'm not really a software developer. Like, I don't have necessarily the same passion that all these other guys or gals do, but I do it well. So am I a software developer? Well, there's things that I do which I wouldn't say I am. In parts of my life, I've done the sculpture work, and people would come into my studio like this and they see all the trappings. There's the raw materials, there's the tools, there's the outputs. So I must be an artist because I'm actually doing that. And yet I have friends that seem to be, you know, that seems to be really their inner nature, that they are more artists in that way. So I look at that and say, well, I don't know. Am I an artist? Why am I doing this? Which is always a good question to ask. You know, what's important? Is all of this involvement actually productive in terms of, you know, either benefiting others or benefiting inner growth? I think it has been. I was much shyer at an early age, so I have to get out there, say, even to do a studio tour and invite people into my studio and then somehow talk to them, you know? Talk to them about the art and then about themselves, using the art as a way of connecting with their experience. When I've had the time to get into the studio and get into that space, it's been at the very least very interesting. And I've found that as I have changed, my relationship to the activity of building art, of let's say not even being an artist, building mobiles. You know, it's constructing things. As an engineer, I work with people and build things. They happen to be pieces of software, but it's still not that different from any other type of engineering. And here it's a personal activity. It's not so much a team activity, but it's building something just to be pretty or just to be interesting or to attract your mind in some way that hopefully you know, opens it up a little bit. You can start, and I certainly started, by going to the hardware store. And you can make mobiles out of a lot of things. Like, I've taught classes with young children, and what we used was colored construction paper, scissors, so those are the surfaces, and then a soft aluminum wire, which you could actually bend with your fingers. So, I mean, it can be very simple, but if you want to make Calder-style mobiles with those materials, you need metal, and the simplest thing that's available is aluminum flashing. It's a great material. Use it for repairing your roof, so it's in any hardware store will have it. Some kind of rod or wire. So this is steel. This is just a medium weight steel wire. What I've found I use a lot, because I like the colors of it, is welding rod. So that's more a little bit more special. You have to go to a welding supply store. We have one in our small town, so they're not too hard to find. So this is a bronze, what they call bronze, welding rod. But it has a wonderful color and a springiness to it. You see, you get to know these materials, but you can start with wire from the hardware store and flashing. When you get up to heavier sheets of metal, so this is a 32,000ths aluminum. These are all hardware store tools, a set of shears. I mean, I've got a bunch of these now, but I find that this pair here I use 95% of the time. Some files, or a file, to shape the metal. Wire cutters. Pliers. That's really about it. So here's a piece of aluminum sheet. It's just flat. That's about it. The only character it has right now is because some other pieces have been cut out of it already. Here's a piece that's in this shape family. These are very simple. A lot of these shapes are basically triangles with a little bit of curve to them. Part of the reason is they're easy to cut. Convex sides like this are easier to cut than concave ones. Lots of variations of very simple shapes that all have their different characters. So this one's kind of narrow and not too pointy, but this particular part of the shape, they'll be different from piece to piece. The intention here isn't that these be all identical. When I have a sense of what that kind of family of shapes is, I'll make a whole bunch of them and lay them out and start sketching it out on the table here, what the flow of the pieces, the connection of the pieces is. I mean, part of the character is that these individual pieces of metal, your mind makes into a single thing. Somehow it becomes a single unit. And how it does that is a question of the composition. If the pieces are too far apart, then there's less connection between them. If there's too close, it's not so spacious. And so you can play with the character in that kind of way. Whether you want it to be really open and the piece is somewhat disconnected and your mind has to do more work to connect them together into one thing, which happens when they move because they're moving in a unit. But in the end, if the piece is effective, those organic forms, if they are organic forms, will all connect together in the mind, in your mind when you view it as somehow one thing that's connected together and but floating in space in a very an abstract way. This piece, I mean, it's all articulated. And there are these joints, and each piece moves relative to the other. But it will always look about like this. It might curl up a little bit more or open out a little bit more. But it's basically going to have the same look of a helical set of leaves. When you're working with an art form, and one of the things you want to do is study the people that did it really well. In the case of painting, there's lots of people to choose from, but if you're doing mobiles, there's really one outstanding person, which is Alexander Calder. Now, there are a lot of people who are doing very nice work with mobiles now, but in terms of studying the master, it would be Calder. Here's a piece of documentation from a Calder book. Cute little piece called the ostrich, small ostrich, and a study I made 20 years ago. There's actually something interesting I learned from this piece, just by making this piece. You know, so in the course of cutting this out, what became clear is that this little yellow piece here, that's the body, these cuts here are circles. Now, he used discs a lot, circles a lot, and so he had cut a circle out here, and he had cut a circle out on this other side, and this was a piece of scrap. The body here was just started life as a piece of scrap. I mean, you can infer it now. It wasn't clear. And in fact, when you cut the metal, it will bend it'll tend to bend. As it gets thinner, it bends more. So even the shape of this yellow piece dripping, whatever it is, melting down there, was probably in the scrap, and then he saw this and said, oh, somehow connected to do something with it. Calder's work was primarily painted in a small number of primary colors, and you can go to the hardware store and buy a water-based primer, because you do need to prime the aluminum for it to bond, and latex paint. From there, you might start saying, gee, I like more colors. I want to go get some, go to the art supply store and buy some acrylics. There's all these great acrylic colors. What I ended up doing in my own interest was approaching these things here, not just as flat shapes in that kind of abstraction. That occurs by texturing it, banging it with a hammer. So here, this is one of those flying pieces. It's just a piece of aluminum that's been dimpled by taking a ball peen hammer on a stump. This is actually a sandbag. It's a tool for custom automotive, motorcycle parts, that kind of thing. What I've liked, though, is it's just working the working this on a piece of wood. It starts as hardware store art, and then you say, gee, I'd like to do some deeper texturing. Maybe I don't want to hit that, use that ball peen hammer so much on my arm, so I'll get a piece of pneumatic equipment to play with. But this is all elaboration of the basic form. I'm going to run along this edge here and follow the same curve I've already put into it to make it curve this way. So the piece is going to curve that way. And I'll do the same thing here, flipping it over so it curves the other way. This tool, it has these characteristics, which were not necessarily what I expected when I bought it. So it opens up a different range of possibilities than I might have originally thought. Now, so all the surfaces are textured now, roughly the same shapes. And this has not gotten very far, so this is something we can play with today. And what I have here are these are really just studies of slightly different ways of working with a texturing. Textured disc, these are a couple other studies for that disc. This has ended up being a little wider. There's more space between the pieces, which is okay, but I think I like it. I think Calder had it better, right? It'd be more interesting to bring these in a little closer together. And so that's something I can actually do at this point. I can actually take this piece and begin playing with it. There's all these different forms, and they move differently. It's not just a question we talked about balance not being static. The question is, how will it move? One very basic element is that here, in this particular mobile, the surfaces are vertical. And a result of that is they'll catch air moving, and it'll catch up air movement. There's other types of constructions where you have a bunch of fairly flat pieces, maybe hanging up above. It has an element of balance, but the air movement is all it's going to do is push it up and down a little bit. It'll get that, but it won't get so much driven around. There's this gap between the technical things that you do to create the piece and that mood in terms of what turns me on. This has been a learning process, because I was not always this way, is interacting with people and having just a direct communication with people. And trying to understand why, you know, what they're dealing with and what's driving them. So a transaction that's occurring around a piece of art, it doesn't have to be a financial transaction, just meeting someone through a piece of art, is just a framework for doing that, where it's bringing people a certain direction and maybe they have a certain interest, but now there's the beginning of a conversation occurs. And it can go wherever it goes. But having the interest in that other person, that's something that is important to me at this point in my inner life. For example, my work as a software engineer, there's lots of interesting problems to solve. And I have the type of, I've been blessed with a kind of mind that's good at doing that kind of thing. So it happens that in our society, you get paid well for that. So it's not a bad thing. But the most interesting part, when I look at it from my value point of view, is what type of quality of experience am I bringing to the people that I work with? Indeterminate display is the expanse of the magical expression of its responsiveness. Am I hearing feedback? You really can't predict, even without someone blowing on it, you can't predict what it's going to do next. Thank you.